Okay, so good morning, everyone. It's our great pleasure to host today at the Deep Distinguished Lecture Series Dr. Alessandro Moschitti. So Alessandro is an old acquaintance. We spent some years together at the University of Trento. He got his PhD from the University of Rome. He then moved for a few years to the University of Texas at Dallas, and then worked as professor at the University of Trento. He has also visited the Qatar Computing Research Institute, and very notably, he participated together with the IBM Watson research team in the Jeopardy Grand Challenge. So this was the time when the IBM system won the Jeopardy challenge against a human, which made large headlines. He has won several awards, including faculty awards and best papers. He's now, for the last several years, a principal scientist, research scientist at Amazon. And in particular, he's working in the Alexa team. He has designed the Alexa question answering system, which is based, among other things, on deep learning. And today he's going to talk to us about this some of these aspects that involve deep learning. Alessandro, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Temis. It's a pleasure for me to give this talk. Thank you for having me. So this it's about my experience on question answering for a large company, and then it can be useful because illustrate step by step the building block of what today we call large language model or generative AI and so on. So I believe that generative AI is seen as a magic. So as it is presented to people, it's not really clear how it works. Part of this experience instead may clarify some aspect. Of course, I will need several hours to go in detail, but there are some aspects that in my opinion you can recognize in the technology and help you to understand it better. So the talk is especially targeting the retrieval augmented generative QA, and I will show you what this means. Okay, of course, this is a joint work with several colleagues and students at Amazon for a long period. So let's start from the motivation. Large language model, as you know, I've shown unprecedented results. And so since the target exactly generation of text, the generation of answer, the answer questions, this seems the ultimate best approach for question answering. For a while, people thought, okay, let's increase the size of this model, perhaps the data, perhaps let's clean it before using the data for training them. We can do fine-tuning, a lot of fine-tuning, and we have a perfect system. In the reality, people understood that this is not much the case. Why? Because this model, when they are asked about information that they don't know, they provide hallucination. And these are even worse than wrong answer, because they make you believe that their answer is correct, is very reasonable, but actually is completely fake. So we need to address the problem of information of LLM, how they can get continuous fresh information. And moreover, it's not only about the freshness, it's also about the exact information and fine-grained information, like, for example, numbers or information that typically is in the table. So they are not so good to reconstruct from their parametric knowledge precise information. So there are potentially only two solutions. One solution could be that researcher design a future neural architecture that can efficiently and accurately represent, access, update web scale information. So basically, you can store the entire web in an efficient way with precision all the information. But this doesn't look possible at the moment. There are some attempts that are not convincing at all. So we are really in infancy in this kind of direction. Or the other alternative is that we put together the parametric knowledge of a large language model with information retrieved by different sources using a standard classic information retrieval. So these are called retrieval augmented answer generation model. Before going in their definition, let me give you some very basic background on large language models to understand what they are. So, and I will start. So, this slide is about a large language model, but basically, it's about a language model. So, what is a language model? A language model is simply a model that tell us the probability in a text of one word with respect to the others. So, basically, what you model is simply this probability. And it's a very old task. So, this is a more than 20, 30 years of history, much longer before we were using even a neural network in natural language processing. So here there is an example, basically, to compute the probability. Just let me say. So we have a suppose that we have a we are generating a sentence. The sentence is the Toronto Raptor won the 2019. So you have this text, and then you want to predict any of the word in any position. Interesting position is the next word if you want to generate a text step by step. So suppose that we have already generated these six words. Now we want to generate another word. So we simply use the language model to estimate the probability of any possible word. So any this is the list of the entire vocabulary. Vocabulary can be 100,000 or 200,000, 300,000, even millions of token. And each of these is a probability. The probability is exactly what the language model compute. And so the idea is that now, as our next step, we'll select the word with the highest probability. In this case, is NBA. And so at the step N plus one, we will have the Toronto Raptor won the 2019 NBA. Note that football has a very low probability because the Toronto Raptors are not a football team. And this is a word that is syntactically appropriate for this for continuing the sentence. So the Toronto Raptor won the 2019. This wouldn't be correct semantically, not even syntactically. So basically, the language model have just this feature to predict the probability of the next word, or in general, to predict the probability of one word given the other words as a context. Large language models are simply language models that are very big. How much big? Well, they are super big. This is the interesting part. While in the past we may have in NLP, I don't know, 5 parameter, 10 parameter, 100 parameters, and so on. With this model, we are going to have billions of parameters. For example, here in scale, there is a log scale of the number of parameters in this language model. And this is a little bit the history of GPT, how it evolves. So starting from GPT-2, T5 started to have 3 billion. Actually, there is also the model 1 billion, 3 billion, 11 billion, then 175 billion. At the end of 2022, already we had a model with 540 billions. So just to make it clear, I mean, if you have some basic knowledge on neural network parameters, it's basically a neuron. And for people that are as much as old or even younger than me, they may re recall that, for example, support vector machine had only one neuron. So this they have instead of 540 billion neurons. So with this kind of number of parameters, you can train a very powerful language model that can predict accurately the probability of a word given the previous word of the sentence, but also very importantly, with respect to the context where this sentence is generated. I think little by little during the presentation, how this is achieved will make more sense. In any case, for the moment, the information is a language model, billions of parameters, and also a nice way to train it on potentially infinite data. And so this is the secret of the language model. Let's see what is the power of these models. So these models are so good to exploit the context that basically in understanding the semantics of the context, understanding for me is always between quotes, basically to compute this probability that I was telling you before, that you can specify even the instruction to generate the next word. So you can modify the generation of the word with context, and you can express this context in a way that is human friendly. Basically, you can really express with natural language semantics. So this is a typical prompt for a language model. So imagine the situation of before. This is the previous text, and then you need the model generate the next word. Now, the previous text, that is the context, you can put a task description. You are a customer service agent that recommend the proper product to your client, and so on. So you describe the situation. Then you also provide some examples, and the examples are very important because they will tell to the model what should be the input out. For example, here you have a summer is coming. I want to buy some new clothes. Do you have any recommendation? So this is the expected input. And the output could be of the sort, thanks for your interest. We have one summer shirt that would be good to try. So you give the model some examples. Then you provide additional context. This is very high-level context. So for example, you say today is 2 July 2023. And this is we are based in Toronto. So the model can associate the parametric model, sorry, the parametric memory with what is typical in Toronto in this time of the year. Then you provide finally your question. Can you recommend me some clothes to buy? And there can be also some additional clue, like it is a list of products. And the model will start to generate one word at the time, like a summer pink shirt. Okay, so this seems really magic because at the end of the day, I repeat, what the language model is what I showed to the previous slide, just generating the next most probable word after all this prompt, all this text has been given in input. But we have evidence that it works. Interesting, to make it work, of course, you need to train the model. So basically, the language model that the training example that you use for training the language model, so to compute the probability of the next word, will have some similar format. So basically, this prompt for getting the answer is also the prompt to train the model, and you will provide exactly this input at the training stage with the answer that is manually created. So again,
Andrew,
it's go ahead.
does the model differentiate between what you call description, example, supporting content, input content?
It does. And for what I see, people may not even use some separator. Some other people use the separator, so basically you can use the tag This is task description. This is example. This is supporting content. This is input content. So that the model can basically understand better how to combine the probability of the different sections. But in general, this model will work also if you don't put any description. Basically, all this input will be just a text. In my opinion, with the categories, it works better. There could be some study in this showing that in some cases it works better, in some other cases not. For example, ChatGPT has been trained to not provide this kind of section because to be more user-friendly, you don't want the user to tell, okay, this is the task description, now I'll give you some example, but so strict. But what the user is doing is very similar, no? Ask a question and then provide some example without explicitly telling these are the subsection. But the model for sure learn that there are this section where you give a description, example, and so on. Okay, so basically, again, I repeat, this seems a little bit magic. How can this model do this stuff? And I want to give you an example of mine because to make it is even more magic. I'm pretty much sure that you play with ChatGPT, so you know that it can do translation, it can do summaries very well, can correct our English or non-native speaker, but even the English on native speakers, and can solve some reasoning problem. So you already know that there are all these magic things that it can do. This example is very interesting because it seems also to have some sort of common sense knowledge, which is the main limitation of this kind of models. So suppose that I put this message in ChatGPT with the request, is this a manipulative message? Honestly, I'm not an expert on manipulative theory or let's say best practice or bad practice, but I wanted to know more about this topic that for me is not common. So I ask the system if this was a manipulative message. If you are a good girl, I send you a gift. Between quotes, sorry, between parentheses, still an emoticon. I inform you in advance, as I don't want you to get deluded. So the gift will be a very simple stuff. The ChatGPT answer was, the message you have shared can indeed be perceived as manipulative. Let's break it down. Conditional reward. So the system understood that this manipulative, okay, this is a simple classification task, but then it's telling me that there is indeed a conditional reward. The sender is offering a gift as a reward, but only if the recipient behaves in a certain way. And interestingly, it captures this reward, this condition. Condition is a good girl, being a good girl. So he understood from text that exactly this part is the reward. And then added something for me surprising, emoticon disclaimer. The inclusion of the emoticon and the disclaimer, I inform you in advance, suggests that the sender is aware of the potential manipulative nature of the message and is attempting to soften it. So honestly, it isn't my interpretation of what the sender wanted to do, but I have to say that this is very convincing and make me think to something new. So, yeah, maybe the sender wanted to soften the manipulative nature of the message. So, for me, this is another example of we are approaching somehow real reasoning. Okay, give you this magic. Now I will try to nail down the technology. But first, to nail down the technology, I also want to point out that these models are far from perfect. So there is an entire section in internet website describing major failures. So for example, Omanison had AIDS and Ezinga in total, The answer seems to be pretty much reasonable. I think I was a Dutch amateur astronomer, blah, blah, blah. I think as a wife, Rinsky Jens, had five songs in total. Actually, had only three. So these five songs in total completely comes out of the blue, making you really in trouble because you trust what he's telling this guy. And then he put you some piece of information totally fake. This other example is even more interesting and tell you that the background knowledge, the common knowledge here can have a big failure. Plato and Laurence Olivier had a closer relationship. Yes, sure. According to some accounts, Plato and the actor Sir Laurence Olivier had a closer relationship and corresponded with each other for many years. Some sources even claim that Olivier visited the Plato's academy in Athens during his travel in Greece. So this is completely made up and completely, let's say, ridiculous, but it may happen. And then there is something more common, is mistaking, inverting some knowledge. For example, who won the 2023 Super Bowl? The winner that game was the Philadelphia Eagles, who defeated Kansas City Chiefs by 31 to 24. Here, simply swapped Philadelphia Eagle with Kansas City Chiefs, who were those that won. And also, 31 to 24 is completely invented. The results was different. So,
Alessandro, these
yeah.
examples come from what kind of model? Is it a recent model or an older one?
Yeah, this, sorry, this I forgot. This is ChatGPT 4. And I tried the example again. At least I tried this Plato example because it was very funny, and the model is not mistaking anymore. But this because this example is in internet and was even tweeted for a long time, so the developer corrected this example. But the fact that they corrected this example doesn't mean that they corrected the entire class or other examples similar to this. This is a big problem indeed. So this was ChatGPT-4. Okay, thank you for letting me know that I didn't mention the ChatGPT-4. Okay, so one of the best, probably the best at the moment model, large language model for this kind of interaction. Okay, so how can we fix the hallucination problem? The idea that I mentioned before is that we can use information from your database that is more reliable. So given the question of the user, you can use a retrieval system that retrieve information from external knowledge. This external knowledge can even be the web. Then you give this knowledge to the generative model as a context, and the generative model produces the answer. The idea is that now, if your information is reliable, the model will not generate hallucination. In particular, for example, for the Kansas City Chiefs Eagle match, he can just retrieve the results from the web, official results from the web, and then he will not invent something else because he will learn to trust the information that you give the model as a fact. Okay, so this is the basic principle, and this is why after some months of ChatGPT, which could only answer question before 2022, Bing ChatGPT come out, which could use Bing as a source of information to answer even question after 2022. Why 2022? Because 2022 was the last year that the model was trained on. So now they are probably updated better the models, but still they cannot update the model with the information of yesterday or not even 1 month ago. So this is why they're using ChatGPT with Bing, because with Bing they can retrieve the information that is live, so happening constantly, thanks to the search engine. So basically, this is the current solution for this models and reduce hallucination, but of course introduce other problems that I will point out later. So yeah, this summarizes a bit what I just said. Retrieve information and generate answer using this information. The benefit are that you can use web databases that can be updated very efficiently, order of minutes. Hallucination are reduced. And moreover, you can retrieve entire tables. And so you don't have the problem anymore to store precisely a table in the parametric knowledge of the model. The challenges are that you move the problem of reliability, accuracy in the retrieval component. So the retrieval needs to be correct, otherwise you are screwing up the answer of the large language model. And the data should be authoritative, otherwise you may give to the model I don't know, information coming from some blog or for some let's say fandom domain. And the other big problem from a research point of view in large language model is how to merge this external knowledge with internal knowledge. Exactly because the external knowledge can be noisy, and so you want to merge in a way that you select only the more reliable knowledge. Okay, let me start now to give some background on this kind of retrieval augmented models. I will be a little bit abstract here because I think I will need to stop in 20 minutes something. So in any case, this related work is pretty much specific. So I will try to generalize it a bit. So one of the first model for retrieval augmented generation was from Liu et al. They used the DPR model. What is a DPR model? It's a neural retrieval model. Neural retrieval model is a model that basically generates embeddings with transformer. I will describe the transformer later. And can embed documents and query as a vector and then operate scalar product. Basically, they are using this retrieval, neural retrieval to provide information to the generator. And this got good results. But basically, when they were using their DPR, their neural retrieval, which is limited because it's done by researchers, they got some results. When they used the MS Marco dataset, which was generated by Bing with a search engine, they got 20% more. So basically, this is a clear example that if you use a weak retrieval, then your performance in generation drop dramatically. Similar good results were achieved by Izzacard and Grave. Here they put together hundreds of sort of document, more than document, they were sort paragraphs. And so the main difference here is that they are fusing many vectors for generating the final answer. This good results, but unfortunately, both of this paper, especially the Izzacard Grave, were focusing on factoid QA. Factoid QA is another interesting concept that you should learn about it. Means that the answer of your question, so you ask question whose answer is just an amenity. So who is the president of the United States? Who won the Super Bowl? These are much simpler questions. So that you just need to generate an entity. And so it's much simpler than generating an entire answer. And so the noise here is much reduced. Glass et al. Showed that you can improve the generator if your retrieval is better. How do they improve the retrieval? By defining a ranker component, re-ranker component, that given the initial results of information retrieval, re-rank the passages in terms of probability to be correct. So it's just a better model. I'm mentioning this because you will see in the rest of my presentation, my work was mostly on ranking the information, getting higher precision information. Then there is this Xu et al. That is my paper. In my opinion, was the real first paper on retrieval augmented generation because we focus on non-factoid, factoid together with non-factoid. Non-factoid means that the input of the answer is a document and the generation also is a long text, so not only unnamed entities. And since this is the topic of the presentation, I don't spend time here. I will illustrate you with the slides. Then we had other papers to improve this technique for generating answer using generating long answer using re-ranked text and some way to train the generator with the re-ranker, which turns out to be, according to OpenAI, reward function. So basically, we also design a reward function probably in parallel to them because we didn't have their model until end of 2022. Okay, and this is another paper about fusing parametric and non-parametric knowledge, but I have a lot of content, so let me go with the slides. So I will give you first some introduction of grounding, which before could have been meant as just a question answering system. So a question answering system today is a grounding system, or sort of. The one that I designed for Alexa was exactly a grounding system, even if we used it as a question answering system. So how does it work? You have a question, what is Mark Twain's real name, for example, and then you have a search engine, perhaps indexed with the web document. The search engine returns you the top K documents, and then you split the document in subsections, typically paragraph. We target mostly sentences. So after this process, you may have a situation like this, a set of sentences that can be potential answer, no? So for example, here we have the number one, you mean someone, Logan Clemens, born 30 November 1835 in Florida, Missouri, which is the wrong answer, by the way. So you may have a long list of these candidates, and for some reason, because you are not always lucky, like in this case, someone, Logan Clemens, better known as Mark Twain, is in the 16th position. So at this point, you need some way to re-rank the information such that the correct answer will go to the top. So you want that the 16 sentences will be on the top, because then if it's in the top, you can select it as a final answer in this case for your system, or as a grounding information for a large language model. Interestingly, the search engine is the efficient part of the system, can retrieves documents from an index of billions of documents, passage, but it's a kind of naive in the sense could be based on bag of words in case of lexical search engine, or with neural retrieval, something more accurate, but still a scalar product. So definitely cannot solve a very complicated problems. Instead, the passage re-ranker runs on a much smaller set of candidates. And so this means that you can put more powerful semantic technology in this component. And I will go through the passage re-ranking modeling, because the passage re-ranking modeling, at least how we design it, basically can be seen as a sort of semantically precursor of what you can see today in LLM. So may help you to understand how LLM can express this powerful semantics. Of course, this is just one way to interpreting it, but it's the intermediate step. So if you understand this, probably you can start to approach, okay, how can this model works? So, okay, passage re-ranking is the task of re-rank document or passages that are relevant to the query. But we want something more precise. So in previous work, this is called answer sentence selection. Different terms, but basically the main difference is we want passages that contain the answer, not only that are relevant. They can be used to answer the question. And these models can rank the passage that answer the question on the top, so you can use it already as a question answering system. How can we do that? Very simply, you can use a binary classifier that classifies positive and negative pairs. So, for example, this is the pairs of before, what is Mark Twain's real name, someone longer claims better known as Mark Twain. This is positive because it's the correct answer. And so we label as one. The other candidates were wrong. Roll over Mark Twain because Mark McGuire is on the scene. This is a incorrect answer. So we have a negative pairs. And so now we need just to learn a classifier, binary classifier, that classify this kind of pairs. Interestingly, for some practical reason, when the classifier learns from these pairs, at the end of the day, it learns to issue a probability of the answer. So not only the binary label is good or bad answer, but actually the probability. And in your ranking system, you use that probability. You don't use a 0-1. You just use the probability that the answer is correct. So you can use a simple binary classifier as a ranker. In previous work, there has been very long, large work on answer sentence selection, so this kind of ranking system, before we had this variegated machine learning model, quasi-synchronous grammar, three-headed distance, probabilistic model, CRF, SVM, lexical semantic models. And then from 2015, we start to have a neural network in NLP, and so also in information retrieval. And so we started to have a neural network like neural variational inference for text processing, attention-based convolutional neural network. Also, my contribution was one of the first for ranking passages, learning to rank short text pair with convolutional deep neural network. In general, there are hundreds of papers that beat the state of the art, so improved little by little the results that other researchers obtained. The state of the art was obtained with transformer models. Transformer models are basically the same architecture of LLM, although recently LLM are trying to make it more efficient. They started typically with a transformer architecture. So the difference between LLM and the transformer that I'm telling you here is just basically in number of parameters, and then the way in which they are trained, because here I mostly mention a mask language model example. They are used with token prediction, which is a or casual learning, which is a another way to train the language model. But for the sake of this explanation, I think mask language model will give you immediately the intuition how this model are trained. So what is a transformer? Transformer is a typically large neural network constituted by building blocks. What you see in the images is a building blocks. Basically, you have some input, then there is a multi-head attention layer, a normalization layer, a standard feed-forward neural network, another normalization layer, and you have one block. This block can be trained, it can be used as a classifier, and so on. The first language model that appear in the history of this transformer-based language model were BERT base and BERT large that were constituted by 12 or 24 blocks for a total of 100 million parameters and 300 million. I repeat, this was the first time that we start really to play with a very large number of parameters. Because before we were playing with, I don't know, some million parameters. Okay, so how can we train these networks? The idea is pretty much easy. Suppose that this is your network. You can give an input to some text, and you invent an interesting task, which is the task that I told you before, predicting the probability of a word given the other word. So it's very interesting because we can generate the data for free automatically. And this is why these techniques have a success, because you can increase the number of parameters, but most importantly, you can produce as much as training data as you want in a very simple way. If you have a text like this, you separate in tokens, and then you mask some token. Mask some token means that, for example, you instead of you substitute the token with some label, mask. Then the model should reclassify among all possible token the token that you have removed. So basically, you can build your training data because you remove the token, and then what is the label? The token that you removed. You can get as much as data you want, and so you can simply train this model with a lot of data. Roberta was the next step, but it's simply a more parameterized model with respect to BERT. As I told you, this is a learn the probability of one word given the other word is exactly the task that you are learning. So what you do with this? An example is exactly passage re-ranking that I explained before. How we can build a passage re-ranking with this language model? Very simply, suppose that this is the network. You see only one layer, but this can be 24 layers, for example. Then you add, at the end, you will have the embeddings, basically the final vector that is used to compute the next word, or in this case, mostly the missing words, not the word that you have substituted, the mask. Okay, so you have a good vector. This is a vector that is pretty much condensing the information of the text that you give in input. And so I can use this representation in a simple binary classifier, so binary neural network, which is just another set of parameters and this vector. So in this case, you have a very simple, I would say, perceptron, where you take this very powerful vector in input, and then you have a binary output. And what you need to do now is just to fine tune, we say, basically training this network for the task that you want to solve. And the task that we want to solve here, for example, is determining if a pair of a question answer pair is correct or not. So you we give it that text, obtain the embeddings of the pairs from the language model, then classify that vector is correct incorrect. This basically make it even more clear what I just said. So we have an input of the transformer model, literally the question, then literally the answer. There is some separation. You remember I mentioned that even ChatGPT may benefit from some separation. Transformer definitely benefited from some separation because are less powerful. And so we give these pairs in input. Then with the language model, we compute the representation of each pair. And then we have a softmax, a feed-forward neural network, basically a classifier. We assign with this binary classifier probability. And then we select the pairs with the highest probability. Is it clear until here?
Yeah, makes sense.
Does it work? Okay, perfect. So basically, I show you how from LLM, what is LLM language model? Okay, let's start from a basic language model. At the same time, I'm introducing the retrieval augmented because the simple usage of language model is a ranker. E the ranker, I will use it later for grounding. Okay. So we improved.
We have, Alessandro, we have 5, 7 more minutes.
Okay. So that is good. So basically, I give you the basics. And for example, we can skip this paper because this paper is just about improving the ranker. Okay. And so show you that you can do some different fine-tuning to improve the ranker. But the idea is always the same. You build one ranker and you get the state of the art. Okay. This is was our improvement with respect to previous hundreds of results from hundreds of papers in different data sets. So we get a good improvement and got the state of the art. 2 minutes I want to spend for the results, qualitative results. So for the moment, I show you a very basic model, doesn't do this reasoning or doesn't seem to do any reasoning, just pairs of classify, pairs classify question and answer. Okay, what are the potential of this model that I just told you? Only 100 million parameters. Well, can answer question of the type who was Don Quixote, but this is simple because it's a very famous entity. I don't go over this example much. Interesting can also answer this kind of question. Who was the Spanish character Don Whatever? So basically the model can already generalize Spanish character concept, adding also some important lexical like Don that characterize the famous character. And so can give you the answer. Don Quixote was a fictional answer by Miguel de Cervantes. So what does mean this? That the model was able to select among thousands of possible text fragments, the fragments that match the question. And the question is underspecified. Interestingly, you can underspecify even more the question like this. Who was the Spanish character had a problem with windmills? So had a problem with me. Windmills is a way to characterize your information need, your question, basically, with a relation, not just with the word done, but basically having a problem. And the model could select the right answer. The fictional character Don Quixote is famous for tilting at windmills. The model was able to match tilting at windmills with the concept of having a problem with windmills. So this model, 100 million, trained as a pairs of classifier, had already inside the semantics to get very well the matching between relations and multiple characterization of the relations. So from here, from 100 million to 100, 200, 300 billions is the difference of what the LLM can do now. But I hope that I'm connecting you with this, the raw element of this technology. What you are learning is just the relations between words, expanding from words to relational information like had a problem, and then expanding even more the entire semantic of the sentence. Okay, here I don't want to spend because I'm running out of time, but basically you can go very specific with specific question. Like technological question. Importantly, this is not LLM, this is just a basic transformer. Okay, I have some results also on the efficiency because this is important. You need to process thousands of candidates. But then, okay, if I have 5 minutes, this would be interesting, but maybe I can get a question after how the context. Was managing in transformer. I want to go now directly to the core of the generative modeling. Okay, so how we design, in my opinion, the first retrieval augmented generative model, and I want to give you another path. Instead of starting from a magic, this model can do everything. Why we define a generative QA starting from a small model, much smaller. So we had this problem with our QA. Using our question answering system, we provide some answers to the annotators. These are two different data sets. The idea was that the annotator evaluated the first answer. The first answer had a performance of 60%, 60, 61. Interestingly, if we ask them if there is an answer, correct answer in the top five, they would tell 99%. So basically, our selector is not doing a great job because has only a performance of 60 when the potential performance is 99. Same story here for another data set that is much bigger, is the Google NQ data set. So the idea is that on the top five, we have potentially the answer. The top one selected by the model that I show you, that is state of the art, super powerful, only 100 million, but super powerful, doesn't select the good answer. So we need something better. And we tried in this paper, joint modeling, try to put together all the candidates and try to infer among all the possible candidates that we have, five candidates, what is the final answer, what is the best comparing the candidate between them. This is this model here that I don't have time to discuss, but the idea is that good improvement, we could improve 2-3%. But there we saw there is a gap of 30%. So how can we solve this problem? We got this idea that I will illustrate with an example. So basically, the typical situation is that you have a question like how long do you need to go to school for get a degree in music? And then you have several candidates. It is possible to get a degree in music education with 4 years and so on. So the first one is incorrect, the second one is correct, others are incorrect or correct. But what you would like to have is a generate an answer of the type, the average time to get a bachelor degree in music is 4 years. So this is the final answer that we want to generate, and then we have a set of candidates that can be correct or incorrect. We noted this aspect here. So of course, the correct candidate has a large match of terms with respect to the generated answer, the one that you would like to that the system generate. And so you see, these are two good candidates. There is a large match. Interesting, there is also some match of words from the wrong candidates. There is still a good match. And there is basically no match with the words of wrong candidates that are not relevant. So basically, the idea is that the model could learn from correct and incorrect candidates to generate the good answer. So even if we don't know on the top five what is good and what is bad, the generator could do that, could do the job. This is the experiment that we did. We use a transformer model again, but this was I show you the encoder. There is also decoder, so for the generator. And we train the generator exactly like the example. We give the question plus five candidates, which is the grounding, and we give the good answer as an example. So this was our way to train the generator. It was in 2021, just to make the time context. And these are the results. Basically, you remember here that the performance has a big gap. The generator could be able to fill the gap pretty much well. So this show us that the generator technology using this top candidate, which is the grounded, it is a good grounding, you can get very high performance. Okay, then we expanded this work with reward functions, but I don't have the time to go toward here, I will jump to the conclusion now. So we had basically the main idea before I go to the conclusion is the main idea of the reward function is that the class, the ranker, give you an indication if a candidate is good or not, right? And so you can put this indication as a loss function in the generator. And so the generator now can learn from the re-ranker what is good and what is not good. This in OpenAI is called relevance reinforcement learning from human feedback. So in conclusion, LLM provides outstanding technology to implement QA, but they may hallucinate. So to solve the problem, you can use retrieval augmented generation, and you need efficient retrieval. And I show you anyway a small model. So a small model give you the intuition that is efficient. Contextual ranking, I couldn't go through this, but I can get a question on it. You can also get a reward function from these ranking models, and this will make you your generator more robust. In general, what is the future of retrieval augmented? Well, I show you something using the web, but you can have semi-structured information from Wikipedia, knowledge graph, user content, other structured knowledge. You need to retrieve from each of these sources. Then you need something to select the content from the sources to have a more accurate information. You put in an LM, and then you can generate information more reliably. The challenges are still how to control hallucination and control the model to not give brain damaging answer. And then interesting research line is how to recognize what is more reliable than others, how to combine different pieces of evidence. I give you some initial idea of 2021, but then we need to go beyond that. And how to use parametrics and noisy grounding to get parametric knowledge and noisy grounding in order to optimize the model. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for this extremely interesting talk. So, are there any questions? So, please feel free to raise your hand. Alessandro, one first question. You talked about this problem of how can we integrate the results of RAG with the internal LLM knowledge. So can you say a few things about that? So how this is done and how useful is this? I mean, should we do it or should we only depend on the RAG knowledge?
No, indeed. So I can first quickly tell you how it is done, and then what is my opinion, of course, because it's an open problem. So how is it is done by the major companies like Bing, Google, and recently even Perplexity. That is the interesting part that we need to understand better. So it's just retrieving the most relevant document, and then give the entire document in input to LLM. Here there are two aspects. First, for example, ChatGPT, now Copilot, basically takes documents that are selected with a pretty much powerful Bing search engine that is Bing. So you need to have this technology that is not accessible to to most of the people. And then they have also ChatGPT, that is one of the best model that we have, a large language model that we have. So if you don't have this possibility, in my opinion, you should be smarter on the type of grounding. So what I started to show here is some piece of technology, like for example, the ranker. The ranker can select piece of knowledge in much more accurate way than a search engine, of a standard search engine. Then, of course, there is the trade-off. Being a Google, they have a huge knowledge to select and technique experience to select documents. Here, you can do better with ranker. So to me, they can do the next step developing more of this technology to select the sub part of the documents. So this is my way to my vision, let's say, to improve this content se selection. And in order to do this content selection, you need to take into account a lot of aspect, context, user profile, and so on. So basically, we need to improve this. The reliability authoritativeness is a big problem that search engine have a much more experience in solving, but that is the other important topic for grounding effectively large language models.
But Alessandro, when the LLM receives the input from the RAG component, how do these two interact with one another? So how does the final what part of the final output is based on the RAG, and what part is it based on the LLM internal knowledge? So how does the model decide how to merge these two?
So right now, Immovinio is done sort of in a magic way, in the sense the model is trained with instructions, okay? And the instruction tells the model how to operate with the content, okay? But the instruction up until now they were created for solving the problem, reasoning problem, answering questions. In my opinion, okay, there have been already several months, even 1 year, from when people realized that we need to use retrieval augmented. So I believe companies that are expert on this field, so probably OpenAI, they are already considering the groundings of the document coming from a search engine and setting some example of instruction. So how the document should be used. And this basically is the way in which you merge the document content, which is external knowledge, with the parametric knowledge of the model, because you instruct how to use this document in your answer. So this is the way in which they are doing it. And the problem is that in my opinion, there are many cases, no? Sometimes you can get some document that give you only some portion of information. Sometimes you can get two documents that are conflicting each other. I think people, document-based, I would like to call them, are using this kind of approach. A lot of example try to cover all possible situation of grounding from documents. My school of thought is a little bit different. We should start immediately in providing the right information, structure better the information input to the LLM.
Okay, thank you. Sylvain?
Yes, thank you very much, Alessandro, for the nice talk. I liked your Don Quixote example with the different level of details that you can give to the question. But I was wondering about the different level of details that you could get in the answer. For instance, if I ask a scientific question, you wouldn't answer the same way, if I'm a scientist or if I'm 5 years old, right?
Okay.
The way I understand it is that right now you would put this in what you should at the beginning, like the context. You would give example. But
Yes.
for instance, you in Alexa, you would know if I'm 5 years old or not. Could you incorporate that
Yes.
directly in the ranking and not have to put that in the context?
Yes. So these are a very good question. And when I produced this model and the technology that was improved over a year already in 2019, and the model was in production already in 2019. And we were already thinking, okay, can we give some personalized answers? It can be done, but the technology was already very powerful. You can saw the example. That was the technology that we had. Couldn't really modify the text to meet the profile of the customer, like you are telling. Suppose that in the profile of the customer there is the information, this is a kid. We couldn't find on the web an answer that is for a kid. I mean, technically, we could have some coverage, okay, in the sense, for example, physics explained to kids. And so, given the fact that we have as a contest kid, we could do ranking and search for that kind of information. That is what we were thinking. Now we have a technology that actually allows us to change the style. So the content at the end of the day is always the same. So if you want to know what is the first law of thermodynamics, that is the basic information. So in my opinion, now the role is this retriever, a ranker that I show you, should just give you the right information. So the first law of thermodynamics. Then is the generator that also LLM that have this ability to generate the explanation, so the text in a style more adequate for a kid or more adequate for a scientist or for a standard person. So these LLM actually are completing what for me was a huge problem because with search we couldn't do that. And in my opinion, the two things can work very well together. But basically, we need to have this difference. On one end, there is the pure knowledge. On the other end, and this, in my opinion, is still retrieval. It's not LLM technology. On the other part, we have the generation, the presentation of the information to people. And these are the LLM. So another way to say is that probably the knowledge should still be based on retrieval techniques, database, structured knowledge, and so on. An LLM should just be a way to present the information, to reelaborate the information, but not to create a new information, unless you want to do some specific creative task, and that is super cool. But if you are providing information, LLM is a way to re-elaborate the information, not accessing to the parametric knowledge of the information. So for me, this can be the two role. It makes sense.
Thank you. Yes, that's clear.
Thank you. It was a very interesting talk. I have a question that is maybe a bit general and maybe a bit provocative as well, but I'll take the opportunity to put it. I am wondering actually where exactly do we stop? Because, for example, a part of what we are doing, we are discussing, for example, combining knowledge graphs with LLMs. We are now discussing adding some ranking with LLMs. If LLMs are doing such a job that they need a lot of help, where do we stop? And then also hearing your last the response to the last question, I add to this kind of questioning. If finally LLMs are not the best to generate what we need. Again, what's their actual role in all that?
Yeah. So before I try exactly to answer this point, but I need to elaborate a little bit better to make it clear. So thanks for giving me another opportunities. So let me tell how I see it, and then just reflect my vision, not even the Alexa AGI or other researchers. It's just my vision. So for me, you have this complex system that is based on two components. One component is for searching information and retrieving it and giving you the raw material. So the piece of information that you need to be elaborated and to answer user question. This is the retrieval technology that I discussed a bit. Then there is the other part that is, I would call answer presentation, content presentation, but given the latest results, I would call also reasoning part. So the reasoning part, the reasoner is LLM. LLM with this parameter shouldn't try to find in their knowledge, in the parameter, the answer. Should just be used as a reasoning component to take the piece of data of the first component, re-elaborate it, and then present the answer. From the true data, correct data that is getting with the first component, the model can even generate new information that is a logic consequence of the information that is already had. So basically, the parametric knowledge and LLM for me is just a way to elaborate the information that you give to the model, but shouldn't rely on his information for providing facts or for providing or even for providing the input of a problem. So yeah, let me see if I can explain it this way. Suppose that you have a problem and you want to solve it. This problem needs some data. So how much is the length of the base of the rectangle? So the parametric knowledge shouldn't try to go to find what is the length of the rectangle. It's the first component that is the grounding component, the retrieval component that gives the data. Once you have all the data, in my opinion, parametric knowledge and LM is the component that should put all the data together and generate the answer. Reasoning about it and generate the answer. So in my opinion, this is the way in which you stop. On the data, you take all the retriever and whatever to get the right data, you stop there, and then LLM will generate the answer. There is some caveat that make it more complicated. LLM can potentially help you also to find the right information. And so there that become a bit of the confusion. The confusion, the opportunity. But we need to always keep in mind this separation of opinion, because otherwise we mix everything together and what we get is just a very noisy model. So I could be agree that the for example, what the LLM can do is, okay, my search models are not so powerful. Can you help me to specify the query, the question in a better query for my modeling? This is an opportunity, but you need to pay a lot of attention, because the typical error is that, okay, LLM can solve and can search for you. No, it cannot, because can do whatever, the same things that a human being can do when they search, can do some approximation, but then cannot do the search for you. Also because it doesn't have the efficiency, basically. This is the main problem. Did I answer better the question?
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, more and more, you know, the concern becomes that we use an LLM, which costs a lot to train and put in place, as a glorified user interface for different tasks, which is great, but not necessarily a very, very demanding job at the end.
Yeah, and I mean, the efficiency consideration is exactly what is also driving my vision, let's say. I don't want to spend billions just for doing some task that I can do with the simpler, cheaper models. Okay, so we need to have a separation. I would use this power to do powerful tasks. If I can do it with a cheaper model, why I should use an LLM? So searching with LLM will cost enormously in terms of latency, parallel architecture, whatever, when I can get the same results with cheaper things. So giving the right role to the right piece of technology, my opinion, is important. And these days or months, we are seeing LLM as the solution of everything. It is not. It's a super good tool that will make our application much, much more valuable. But you shouldn't use it inappropriately everywhere. For example, also for generating data, yes, can be good, but pay attention, can generate some kind of data. There are, in some cases, cannot generate adequately the data. Also, evaluation can be used to do evaluation, but just for some type of task, can get a good accuracy. Other very complicated task just gives is or they, let's say, hallucinated viewpoint of the problem. So we need to pay a bit attention to the usage of LLM.
So we're over time. Let me just ask one last question, since you mentioned efficiency.
Yeah.
So in all this pipeline, so what are the the efficiency bottlenecks and the opportunities for improving efficiency in terms of future work? And I would like to also ask you to comment on the vector similarity search. So how
Yes.
important this role is in this context?
Yeah, so just to clarify, you are talking more about the grounding part or the LLM part, the bottleneck where?
No, I'm talking about the inferencing part, right? So I as a user, I want to ask a question. So from that point on, what are the bottlenecks in terms of efficiency in generating
yes.
until the answer is generated?
Okay, but in a RAG system, no, where you have also the
Yes,
retrieval.
yes, yes.
So you have a different type of bottlenecks. So in the latest technology of information retrieval is now using these neural embeddings. And with respect to lexical, you see that for the lexical, you didn't have a really big bottleneck. No? And Google has been working for decades on billions of documents, and we are pretty much satisfied. Now that we are introducing more powerful models, there is some bottlenecks in using these embeddings on the entire web. So is still, I mean, is still both expensive and it has some challenging in latency if you use a neural approach, and the neural approach is still a scalar product, but the embeddings are generated, sorry, the vector are generated with a pretty much powerful neural networks, so for example, transformers. One bottleneck is that to do this scalar product efficiently, because also the scalar product is not done with lexical search, so there is no scalar product, there is a approximated scalar product. You need to do approximated scalar product also for these embeddings. Representation. And so you have this KNN algorithm approximated search. So that can be a bottleneck in accuracy, but at the end of the day, if you invest a little bit more latency, you have a similar results that you would have with the scalar product. And so basically, from a technology viewpoint, there will be some engineering improvement, but the problem is doable. So you can implement this neural technology on large scale. And so this part, more than bottleneck, is how much you want to trade off efficiency for even more accuracy. So I see a clear path. On LLM, I don't see a clear path to to improve efficiency regarding search. There is a good path on improving efficiency on generating answer from the parametric knowledge. We have been seeing that the LLM is answering much faster. So the future bottleneck will be to use in the prompt more and more content. So at the beginning in Transformer, we could use 512 tokens. In a large language model, you can use thousands of tokens. Why I'm talking about this? Because you saw the prompts a small prompts that I show you at the beginning. There you may want to put many more examples, because more example you have, the better will be your specialization of the application. And more instruction, and above all, people are wants to put an entire document there. So you need to have a possibility to have an input a larger context. So to me, one bottleneck is so having the possibility to efficiently provide more context, so a larger prompt. Another bottleneck of LLM is the fact that first of all it's very costly to be pre-trained. Okay, that is super super costly. The other bottleneck is and this is mostly given by the fact that these models are not given they're not given access. Most of them do not allow you to fine tune. So the other bottleneck is we would like to fine tune this model with the right task. If we cannot fine tune, that means basically continuing pre-training the models, the only possibility that we have is the prompt, so the bottleneck that I was telling before. So you need to put the example in the prompt. But if you want to put 1,000 example, they will simply don't fit, even if the sample is small. So some interesting solution is how to fine-tune efficiently and also see if people can give access of their model for fine-tuning, because otherwise, for example, you cannot use ChatGPT fine-tuning in your application. You need to use what I told you before, that is called in-context learning. So with the example that you plug there, which is not only in terms of size of the input, bottleneck inefficiency, ma also the fact that to give an answer, this guy need to read the entire huge prompt and give you the final answer. And this, of course, impact a lot on the speed to generate the final answer. So for me, this in the LLM field are the biggest bottleneck that people try to solve.
Okay. So thank you very much for all the answers and for the presentation. So I'd like to thank you once more for the talk, and thanks for everyone that participated in the audience. So I'm
Thank
gonna
you.
I'm
Thank
gonna
you very
stop
much
the recording.
for having me here. It was an interesting discussion, and I hope you enjoyed. Of course, I have other couple of hours of presentation, but that were pretty much technical. As a first talk, this I think it's enough. Thank you very much.